Those who weren't here last week, we did a Father's Day message last week, obviously for Father's Day, and we didn't finish. We didn't get halfway done. So I believe I said last week we will finish next week. So we're going to try to work on finishing there. You have a new outline, a handout in your bulletin there. And what we need, what America needs, is for the church. And it'll never happen in the church, folks, till it happens in the home. And it'll never happen in the home until it happens to you. We need a revival. As goes America, as goes the American church. When it gets weak and shaky, when these folks get preoccupied or doing other things, you know, without a vision, the Bible says the people perish. When people get their own vision, going with that instead of God's vision, then there's where America will go. Because not only are we the high percentage of America, but we're the best part of America. So if the devil gets us shaken and weak and preoccupied in our own life, he gets greater and greater foothold in America. And what America ultimately needs is revival. But revival who? If you had to pick one group of people, it needs to be the men. It needs to be the husbands to be biblical leaders. It needs to be the fathers to be biblical leaders. Because we are in trouble. Now, I shared last week some stats that I want to real quickly refresh your memory. Now, remember, this survey was taken for over 2,000 people all over America. And these were people, young people, who are now adults, who grew up going to church. Grew up being carried to church, and now they're out of the house, and now they're making their own decisions. And it's a survey from all over, not just the Bible Belt, but all over America, what they have to say. A third of them said that church has and will continue to play a major role in their life. That means two-thirds didn't think it made any difference in their life. Somewhere between 70 and 95% of young people who grew up in a church are leaving the church when they leave mom and daddy's house, never to return. 85% of kids do not embrace a biblical worldview. These are church-going kids. 63% do not believe that Jesus is the Son of God. 58% believe that all faiths, the Muslim faith, the Christian faith, the Hindu faith, all faiths have equal value in their teaching. 51% don't believe in the virgin birth. 65% doesn't believe in a real Satan. 68% doesn't believe in the Holy Spirit, doesn't believe in heaven or hell when someone dies. Folks, we got kids by the droves. They're not kids anymore. Now they're having children, which are your grandchildren, great-grandchildren, who are walking away from the faith. Has there ever been a time when the church says, I've had enough worship in me? I've had enough doing it my way and compromising in my house? By the way, don't try to do in the church house what you're not willing to do in your own house. Don't try to set a rule or hold a standard in the church house if you're not willing to hold that standard in your own house. And that deserved an amen. Because we got folks walking away fast. So what do we do? We turn to government. They'll say throw more money at it. Let it go more to hell's direction. Well, that ain't working, is it? What do we need to do? We need to turn to Jesus. We need to get to the point that I'm sick and tired of my home not having peace. I'm sick and tired of my life not having peace and fulfillment and quit making excuses and compromise and say, well, it's a different... As a preacher, I am tired of hearing the excuse. Well, it's a different time now. Kids are different now. The standards are different now. Not according to God's Word. By the way, that will always be in my house a foreign concept to my children. It's not just because Susie, Bobby, and whoever else live together, the Bible calls it sin. And it's not okay. And just because the Supreme Court said something, the Bible says something different, and He ultimately is my authority.
Amen.
See, it's easy to get amens on things like that. But dads, husbands, clean up your homes. Get serious about Christ. I mean, what's our text verse? We're going to jump around the Bible, but it's the same one as last week. Joshua 24 and verse 15. Joshua says, I'm sure Tim will put it up on the screen, if it is disagreeable in your sight to serve God. Folks, let's just be honest. If it's not something you're willing to do, if it's not something you're going to say, hey, that's me, I will serve God. And some have already made that decision, even though they sit in church, that now they're going to follow Jesus. They're going to compromise, live with that compromise, and suffer the consequences for that sinful decision. If it is disagreeable in your sight to serve the Lord, Joshua very clearly says, choose for yourself today whom you'll serve, whether the gods which your father served beyond the river, or the gods of the Ammonites in which the land you're living. So he's drawing a line in the dirt. And he said, guys, serve. Pick who your God's going to be. Well, folks, we're past that point. We've already picked our gods. And really what we need to say is not pick our gods, return back to Almighty God. Because see, I can sit in a pew all for years and years and years. And I can sit in a Sunday class years and years and years and not walk with Jesus. Compromise on God's Word. Over and over and over again. Oh, I can get an amen when I talk about the Supreme Court. I get amen talking about what those weirdos are doing over in California. But what about your own household, fellas? I won't get as many amens on that one. But Joshua says this. He said, guys, you need to choose who your God's going to be. But guys, let me tell you, I've already chosen. And guess how many people got a vote in my house? One. Me. And this is what came from my vote. But as for me and my house, who's my house? Everybody living under my roof. Maid servants. Everyone under my roof, under my authority. But as for me and my house, we've already voted we will serve the Lord. Oh, but it was easier in Joshua's day. I don't think you want to trade places with Joshua. I mean, it was easy for old Joshua to say that. He didn't have this rebellious teenager. You know what Joshua was saying there? The rebellious teenager will fall in line or he'll fall out of the house. Because he's already decided he wants to serve another God. He didn't say he would not stop being his daddy. He said, you won't be under my house. Because there was one vote in my house and I made it before the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord because I will stand before God and give an account. Fellas, all the world that we live in with trying to pay the light bill and all this, don't ever lose one absolute truth. One day you, for a fact, will, and no one slips through the crack, will stand before God and you'll stand there alone. And you will answer how you led that house. You will answer for compromising. You will answer when the fishing hole was more important than the church house. You will answer when going on paying money, going on vacation was more important than writing the tithe check. You will answer how you led or did not lead according to the Word of God, and so will I. And Joshua understood that. He understood it so much that he made a decision. As for me and my house, the decision has been made. We will serve the Lord. And people say, I don't like that kind of preaching. No, you probably don't. By the way, if you liked all kind of preaching, it probably ain't do you much good. You need to get right with Jesus. We need a revival in homes. You know why we don't have revival in church? Because we're not willing to have revival in our house. I tell you this, you get a revival in homes, it'll be an overflow. It'll flow right into the church. And it'll affect America the way the media has never seen it. They'll have no explanation for it. People getting right, doing right. And the government didn't play a role in it. I don't understand it. Because God did it. How's your homes? Now, last week, we only looked at four. I meant to get further last week, but our time got away from us a little bit. We first looked at the daddy, the husband, the spiritual leader. By the way, the world makes daddy look stupid, doesn't he? Daddy's an overgrown child. Mama makes the decisions. Mama keeps the house in order. Well, what would we do without mama? You know the problem with that is? The Bible says the man is the spiritual leader at home. The world, the commercials, everybody, daddy's stupid, or at least not as sharp as mama. And God said, yeah, but he's my leader for that house. And by the way, so many times I get in a car and I just thank the Lord that I have a wife that is submissive to me. I don't have to fight that battle. I have to deal with autism and all that. I don't have to fight that battle. I know where her support is. I wish more men had that kind of wife. I wish more women would be willing to trust the Lord that much. She's not flawless. Jesus had died for her sins, but I'm grateful for her. I am really grateful for that example. Let's make sure we need men to be saved. Last week we also talked about we need men to be on fire for Jesus. We're on fire for everything else. Ball games, dollar bills, fishing holes. We need to be almost on fire for Jesus Christ. We're on fire for our children, our grandchildren. We can't stop talking about them. But we don't say a whole lot about Christ. We need men to walk by faith because that's what we're called to do. And that is the only way we can glorify God. Now today I want to talk about a point that I added this week. We need to reject. By the way, that's a physical movement. We have to choose to reject. I can't just sit still and think it's going to happen. I need to get busy, get involved, and take steps to reject being passive. I think we live in a time today, maybe more than ever, where men in the church are very passive. They just let things go. Well, I know I should stand. I know what the Bible says, but let's just let this one pass on by. I hope I have I pray to God, I probably will, but I hope I never have another conversation where men in the church, we talk about them out of the church, they say, preacher, I know you're right, I know the Bible says that, but let's just let it go. Let's just pray about it. Well, the Bible says we need to take a stand. I know, preacher, and you're right, but Susie might get upset. So we're more worried about Susie than we are honoring Jesus? Well, no, preacher, let's not put it that way. Let's find another way so we can live with it better. Amen? Being passive. Let's do a little Bible. VBS is around the corner. Let's do a little Bible trivia. When Jesus and the disciples went down to the temple and they saw the mockery man was making of God's house, did Jesus say, fellas, let's not worry about it? Then he said, hey, fellas, I don't like this, and we're going to give them today, and we're going to come back tomorrow. And they do it again, buddy, they're mine. Is that what he said? He took immediate action, didn't he? When God's nature is at stake, dads, listen to this. Jesus Christ took action. He didn't sit by and say, let's wait another time. Let's let this one blow by. Hey, you know, and sometimes, men, we get spiritual, don't we? Let's just pray about it. I don't need to pray what God's made clear. I don't need to pray about some things God's made clear. And when the sin threatens and comes in God's house, God's home, and hurts the characteristic of God and mocks the character of God, I don't need to pray about it. God's made clear what I need to do. I don't need to be passive. I need to be so full of Jesus that I won't tolerate it. Amen? I love the story of David and Goliath. Here you have a little boy. He had a great big giant. And all the cowards in the army, they're passive. And David's kind of confused. Why are y'all being so passive? God's with us. This is wrong. Stand up for God. They're like, you know what? That still goes on in churches. So here's old David, little shepherd boy, goes out there, big Goliath, insulted. Why'd you send me a boy out here? And he starts telling David what he's going to do to little David. And what did David do? Did he run away? Little David said, no, my friend, because I'm on God's side, let me tell you what I'm going to do to you. That's the kind of men we need. And even boys, when they walk with God, can have that kind of fire for Jesus. But see, men, when they don't walk with God, they're sitting up here on top of the hill where it's safe in their little armor suit saying, I ain't going. By the way, what cowards would let a child go? But see, they were more worried about their own skin than taking a stand for the name of God. And men, I'm going to tell you something. It'll never happen. Revival will never happen in church until it happens in your homes. So you become the spiritual leader of your house. By the way, we used the word submission a few minutes ago. I did with my wife. You know, the world has a lie for the word submission. It's ugly. The world hates that word submission. Listen, the Bible is full of Jesus submitting to the Father. He's the Son of God. You think Jesus saw that word as ugly? He saw that word as beautiful, as honoring, respectful. The world has a lie for every one of God's truth. It's up to you to decide which definition you're going to believe. But we're talking about not being passive. How about Revelation? In Revelation chapter 3, verse 15 to 16. I know, God says, I know your deeds, that you're neither cold or hot. And I would that you were cold or hot. So because of your lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. By the way, there where it says, God says, I'll spit you out of my mouth, it literally means because of being nauseous. Do you know that apathy, being passive, your apathy, your passive mind causes God to be nauseous to the point that He wants to vomit, that He wants to spew us out of His mouth. Old David, when he stood before Goliath, he didn't make God nauseous. The army boys did. David, when the Goliath started, matter of fact, when Goliath started telling him what we're going to do, David said, let me tell you what I'm going to do through God. I'm going to cut your head off. Folks, we need men to be biblical men. We need daddies to be biblical daddies. We need them to quit compromising and staying up on top of the hill where they think it's safe. I don't want God Almighty to be nauseous because of my attitude and my surrender to His heart. Amen? Secondly, we need dads to teach by modeling, to live a life as a giver. Not a taker, but a giver. Not one that holds on with every ounce of strength they've got to the little pennies they got, and the little time they got, the little energy they got, the little stuff they got, but to live like this. To be a giver. To be like Jesus. You know what we do? We live like this. You say, no, I don't, I tithe. Well, then you live like this, and you hit 10%, then you live like this. That is not biblical. The biblical life standard is this all the time. To be a giver. And I'm going to tell you, and I mentioned this on a Sunday night a few weeks ago, and I want to share this with you. I was praying, and I've always tithe. I've always given above my tithe. I always have. And I've always pretty much been a cheerful giver. I don't understand all that. Been a cheerful giver. Because I remember what it was like when I was in charge of me. And listen, I want Jesus in charge of my books, my calendar. I want Him in charge. I don't want to go back and revisit me in charge. And when I do and I get in charge, I run to the altar. I don't let pride keep me in the seat. I get to the altar. And I say, Lord Jesus, forgive me. What about what Susie thinks? I don't care what Susie thinks while I'm at the altar. I want Jesus to be right with Jesus. And a few weeks ago, I was sharing, Noah was going through a cycle of not sleeping, and I was just thinking and praying. And I thought about, and I was having problems, and I was having needs, and I was thinking about God's Word and this verse that I've heard, and you've heard many times. And we have studied many times. Just came alive to me in a little more depth than I was used to. It's Malachi chapter 3 and verse 10. Malachi says, God says, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse. so there may be food in my house. Test me, God says, in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour out for you the blessings until it overflows. And folks, when I was up thinking about that, I was a tither. I was giving on top of tithe, on top of tithe. And God made that verse come alive to me. Tab, do you have needs? Absolutely, I have a need. I have several needs, God, that are burned to me. Well, you need to get God more in the equation, not less in the equation. You need to surrender more to the Lord. Does he not say, test me and I will open the windows of heaven? And I needed God. I needed more insight. I needed more God revealed to me. I need more of God involved. And you know what I did? I said, okay, Jesus. You know what I didn't do? Well, God, let me remind you what I already give. God, let me remind you how many bills that autism costs. I know some say everybody's got their own problems. Only problem with that, it's not in the Bible. I didn't do that because, you know, God's aware of all that better than I am. So me and God continued to talk. And God led me to a percentage to give. A good bit north of 10. And I didn't argue. God, let me remind you what I give. Let me remind you about this. Remind you. He knows all that. Tab, you got needs? Yeah. You want God more in the equation or less? More. God says, test me here. See if I don't open up the windows of heaven. But see, I can't live like that. Expect the windows of heaven to be open for me. Can I? Test me means I got to live like that. So we did. We are. We will continue to. Because I believe I will always have needs that I'll need God more in the equation. And then I realized this, how prideful and ignorant it was of me to keep God out of the equation. You know why God has used the poor widow for over 2,000 years to reach who knows how many people? Because she put God in the equation of everything. Now those other boys, you don't know who they are. He said he watched others give money out of their surplus. You don't know who they are. They didn't want God too much in the equation. The poor widow says, all I got is God. I'm going to put him all in the equation. And God has used her and used her and used her. Until we get to heaven, we won't know how many times. We need dads to model by teaching by modeling. We need moms to come alongside that. That you live a life as a Christian, as a giver. Not as a holder on or whatever else you got, and not as a taker, but as a giver. Amen? Ah, folks, that deserved an amen. We need dads to model by teaching how to hear from God. How to hear from God. Dads won't always be there. Even godly dads won't always be there. Hey, not always, and God, even godly dads don't give godly advice always, do they? But if you learn how to hear from God, you always get godly counsel. You always know the right way to respond. In Jeremiah chapter 33 and verse 3, God says, call to me and I will answer you, and I will tell you great and mighty things which you do not know. I need to learn how to discern the voice of God better and better. How do I do that? By spending time with God. Spending time in His Word. So I can recognize truth from lie. You know why we get tripped up so much? We can't recognize truth from lie. Because it sounds good, feels good, makes sense, other people are doing it, must be the right thing to do, let's go do it. But God says, call to me and I'll tell you great and mighty things which you don't know. How to hear. By the way, let me say something about how to hear from God. Now there, God's talking about things that we run into all the time, that we pray about all the time, the things that we can't clearly find answers in the Bible, right? Should I move and take this job or not take this job? What college should I go to? Should I marry this person or not marry this person? If I am supposed to marry, when are we going to get married? We have to make those kind of questions, answer those questions all the time, amen? Amen. I mean, that's not a trick question. All the time. So we pray about it. But one of the things that you and I must realize and believe and start changing our life towards is, as we pray about, should I marry this person and all this, which is not clearly defined in the Bible, we need to first make sure that we're obeying and submitting to the things that are clearly defined in the Bible. There's some things a sovereign God has said that only comes by prayer and fasting. Amen? But there's some other things that a sovereign God said, you don't have to pray about this. I'm going to make it clear in the Word of God. So before I start seeking God's heart out about the things that only come by prayer and fasting, I need to make sure I'm obeying the things that He's made clear to me. Amen? Dads, it'd be a great lesson to teach our kids and grandkids how to hear from God begins by obedience to the Word of God. By putting the Word of God into decision-making that we make. Amen? Amen. And I promise you this, the church will never change if the home changes. And by the way, committee members, you don't need to be uncomfortable or feel any way if I say, how did you come up with that decision? Because you just say, no problem, I found it right here in the Bible. Fits right into content. I didn't pull it out because you know Colts could pull a verse out and get to say something. It fit right into contents of what the Bible was talking about. Because should we make a decision without the Word of God? Because we're trying to learn how to hear from God, right? And you'll never hear from God if you divorce yourself from the Word of God. Man, our time gets away from us. Let's do one more. Let's do two more. And you can take the outline home and read it and pray through it yourself. Proverbs chapter 29:18a teaches that we need dads and fathers to model how to live God's vision, God's purpose for their life. The Bible says, where there's no vision, the people what? Perish. Perish means they go and do what they want to do. If I don't choose to continue to keep myself submitting to God's purpose, whether finding the Word of God and do what God's called me to do for my household, then I will go do what I want to do. I will make the dollar do what I wanted to do. I will make my calendar do what I wanted to do. I will spend my time, my energy, my things doing what I want to do instead of training that to my kids. That's what you do. Instead of teaching them, no, you hear from God. And we're here to walk and serve God. We're here to be all in for Jesus. Amen? And I'm going to tell you this. I'll tell you this, black and white as it can be. The reason why some in the church are servants, is all sold out, have a servant attitude, and some in the church do not, is because they do or don't do it in their own homes. I guarantee you, if I go to Ed's house, I'd find Ed a servant in his house. I guarantee you, if I go to Jenny's, I find that she's serving somehow, some way, at her home, to her family, her sister, siblings, and nieces and nephews. And it's just an overflow into the church. And we need a model to our children that what we do, because remember what Joshua asked me in my house? See, Joshua chose, fellas. What we need to do is make that choice like Joshua did and model for them what a servant is. Model them what living out the vision, the purpose of God looks like in the household you live in. Because one day, fellas, listen to this. They're going to grow up. They might be talking about your kids, your grand. They're going to grow up. They're going to move out of your house. And they're going to go to university so-and-so. And that is so awesome. And they're going to get this degree. And that's so awesome. And they're going to make this kind of money. That is so awesome. But I don't want mine. You know those percentages we read at the beginning? I don't want mine in those percentages. And see, I won't have authority over them anymore because they're out of my house. Remember, Joshua said, me and my house, they won't be part of my house. They'll still be mine, but they won't be part of my house. Now they'll make their own decisions. And I don't want mine part of that as percentages. So I need a model, teach, that we walk with the vision of God and not for the purpose of man. By the way, this whole debate, this whole split down the middle controversy, this whole Supreme Court decision, is this at war right here? God's vision, God's purpose for marriage, and man, what man wants. That's all it is. It's just an application of two different hearts. But we've never seen that before, but we've seen other things to different applications of two different hearts. And fellas, you better get the heart of your house under the authority of God. Now I want to end with this one. It's the last one. We need dads to be spiritual leaders. We need dads to stand up. We need dads to be real biblical men and not to be passive. And I love this verse from the King James, 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5. And spare not the old world or the ancient world, but saved Noah, the eighth person. Did a little study on that. Did some praying and meditating on that. And I could just pretend with me. I could just be saying, Noah, the eighth person he saved. So how many were before Noah? Not a trick question. Seven. Isn't that where daddy needs to be? In the back. Why does daddy need to be in the back? Because nobody's going to slip past me. They're all getting on the boat. But if I'm in the front, somebody might not make it. And I'm responsible for those eight. Amen? What if it was a difficult child that said, I'm not going. You're not going to tell me what I'm going to do. You don't know what I've done? He'd have snatched him by his hair and said, you're going to get in that boat because I said so. Because God's called me to this position. Now, when you're ready to be a man, get gone. By the way, it won't be long. You wish you was in this boat. We got too many daddies not doing what Noah did. And what if it was a little smart? I could see if he was living today, Noah might take off his belt. He said, you got two choices. You can get in the boat, or you get beat, then get in the boat. But you're getting in the boat. And you know what? We've got daddies and granddaddies. So I say, well, where's old Timmy? Well, he didn't want to come today. He didn't feel like it. Now I'm stepping on toes now. He didn't feel like it. You're not being Noah. That's not what Noah would have done. Well, I don't like to force him because I want him to make his own decision. I don't want to influence. Well, you've already influenced him then, darling. Sir, you've already influenced. And this is your influence on him. Instead of teaching the goodness of God, you're teaching God's not that big a deal. You choose. As a child, you make a decision that will affect you for all eternity. That's brilliant. As you let a child make a decision that will affect him for all eternity. And God's put you in a position of leadership in his life. We need men to say, you will get on the boat. You don't get a vote. You ask for me in my house, and buddy, you in my house. You will get on the boat with or without a beating. And by the way, beating is a biblical thing. And we have more beatings, we wouldn't have as many problems. And we have more hugs and kisses, we wouldn't have as many problems. And daddy's invested. It's the whole boat. And I thank the Lord for grandparents willing to bring grandchildren to the church, but daddies need to be the one bringing them. Absolutely. And if not, we need to pray daddies get saved and start bringing them. Because Christ needs to matter in the house. And fellas, I have pastored a church with the most passive men I've ever. Nice as they can, they take the shirt off their back. Don't ask them to take a stand against sin, though. If you need help, they'll be glad to help. Don't ask them to stand up. Don't ask them to stand up against Jezebel. That wasn't Noah. That wasn't David. That wasn't Joshua. And by the way, fellas, Jesus told us that wasn't him either. Will it be you? Will you be the spiritual leader of your home? Will you stand up and say, by the grace of God, I will lead my house? You know, wives, for that to happen, you're going to have to learn how to submit to authority. You're going to have to learn how to quit trying to ramrod things. You know, one of the reasons I get to be the spiritual leader is because my wife chooses to step back out of love for the Lord. We can't have, there's no healthy body with two heads. Amen? The wife is the heart of the home, but the man is the head of the home. And when it stays in that order with God on top, it's a healthy home.